We ready for communion? You can talk to me if you like. In Romans chapter 5, it says this: when we were utterly helpless. I really like that phrase. I don't know why I like it, because nobody likes being utterly helpless. But the promise in this phrase of when we were utterly helpless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. So the act of love happened before we loved him. That's sacrificial love, isn't it? To love somebody before they even think about loving you. That's a special kind of love. Christ loved you before you loved him. God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from condemnation. Who here has been made right by the blood of Christ? Okay. You've got a healthy self-esteem in the kingdom. You have been made right, which means the Lord himself has flown open the door and welcomed you in and said, Trevor, I just want to have dinner with you tonight. That's the conversation of the King. We have been made right with God by Christ's blood. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his Son while we were still his enemies, we will certainly now be saved through the life of his Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends with God. How many friends of God do we have here this morning? Again, you can put your hand up as a friend with the Lord. And this morning around this communion table, this is just a symbolic statement of us once again entering into that covenant with God, that promise with God, to know that yet again that we are eternal, yet again that we are saved, yet again Christ has done everything for us. So through, and you guys know the story, through the bread represents Christ's body that was broken, and through the grape juice it represents his blood that was shed. And us eating and drinking that together this morning is a statement of unity. It's more than that. It's a statement of family. We are family. We're going to give thanks to God for the bread. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we just give you thanks for just, it's simple bread that's here on the table, but it is not simple what it represents. Represents a love of such magnitude that for all of our days we'll still be trying to get our heads around it. And that's the kind of love that you have poured out upon us way before we loved you. So Father, we rejoice in the simple fact that you loved us. We receive this bread now as the body of Christ. Once again, we hear that familiar story of Christ at the Last Supper and just pouring out one glass of grape juice or wine and sharing it with his disciples and speaking of the great promise that was about to be in his blood being shed so that you could walk into a place that we call forgiveness, and even more so, let's just call it family, because that's where he's invited us into. You're going to be served with a cup. I want you to hold on to it and we're going to drink together. Let's pray.
Lord God, we've just been singing the line in the previous song, the wonder of your grace, Lord. And to actually stop and think about how big that is, Lord, and how far it spans. Lord, it's a mind-blowing thing, Lord. It's hard to actually grasp just how big that love is, Lord. But you've given us the best example of it, Lord, in dying for us on the cross, Lord, and shedding your blood for us. Forgiving our sins, Lord, and giving us new life, Lord. I pray that as we drink, Lord, that you just help us to remember what you've done for us, Lord, and to perhaps give us a new understanding of that love, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
I drink all of it, my friends, and be thankful for what the Lord Jesus Christ has done on your behalf. And I just want to pray. Father, hope is what we're going to be speaking about in a minute. And hope is, Father, of what you poured out to us through Christ 2,000 years ago. You opened those avenues, those pathways for us to come to you, to be invited to you, and to be family. And so, Father, this morning, as we turn our hearts to the Word of God, that you'll open our ears to hear your voice, to sense your spirit, to understand your leading. And Father, I pray that that will impact us at a level that we go out into our communities and our neighborhood, our city. And Lord, be that light on a hill, be that example, be that representation of hope. Father, I just pray in this place this morning, Lord, that you'll give us new insights as to where we show that kind of hope. So this morning, I pray that you'll open our ears to hear you speak. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I'm going to get Pauline to come up and give you the Word of God. It's one verse, Romans chapter 15, verse 13. Leave the verse up.
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. God, who is the source of hope, I want to talk about source. Can anyone see this? If you can't see this, you're sitting too far to the back, right? You've got to come to the front. Is that right, Roseanne? You're sitting too far to the back because you've got to see this stuff, because this is, it's just about divine. There are a few things that I would connect with the Father in heaven, and this source is one of them. As you can see, I'm stroking it. I enjoy it. It's nearly run out. I can't find where to buy another one. Audi is where we got it from, and they're not restocking it. And Jake and I enjoy this very much. Very much. To the point, for the last couple of weeks, we've been, you can see, like, you know when you first get the sauce bottle and it's full and you just go, yeah, well, I can throw a bit more in that and I can have a bit more of that. And then all of a sudden you realise the bottle is running out and there's no more in the shop. So you start little bits and just enough. But this sauce is fantastic. This sauce satisfies me. This sauce brings me joy. You know when you have that medium rare rump steak, it's just cooked just right. You know what I mean, guys and girls. Let's just not limit that. And it's just got that juice in it, and you just put a little bit on it, and you just add that to it, and there's something that sits in your mouth that you just go, I just could eat this all day, every day. It's just, there's something that satisfies you when those things come together. Who's with me? It's kind of spicy, so if you don't like spice, you're probably not going to be this, you're not going to be so thrilled with Sweet Baby Ray's wing sauce and glaze. If you're shopping and you find this, even if you don't like it, invest in it. ...474 milliliters of goodness. It's a source that brings to me satisfaction and joy. My kids, when they were at school, they do an experiment with bicarb soda and I think vinegar, is that right? Or was it Coca-Cola? It was one of the two, but they make a volcano out of it. You know, they put those two things together and something overflows from that. If you put this together with a rump steak, what overflows is satisfaction and joy. But there's also hope, because right now I'm thinking of lunch. And I'm thinking of this last little bit of sauce shared between Jake and I, and my mouth is already watering, right? The Bible says that God is the source of hope. Now, I know it's spelt differently, so please don't come to me afterwards and say I've taken it out of context. God is the source of hope. And the Apostle Paul says this to the Roman church. Now, put it in context. Why would the Apostle Paul be calling the church to be in hope? Think about it. Because they're going through a hopeless time, right? Whenever hope wants to break into your world, it's not when things are going swimmingly, it's usually when you are walking through a dark valley, usually when there's a heavy time in life, and that's when hope needs to be announced and declared and for you to be able to receive that. Like this source. I can tell you all about it, and you're not touching this source after the service. I will put it away, so don't even think that you can open this bottle and sniff it. I am not wasting, not a little bit. God, who is the source of hope, the Apostle Paul says this. Well, he says, I pray. I love it, because this is a prayer I want to pray for our church here today too. Paul says, I pray that God, who is the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace as you trust in him. Now, I sat and thought about that verse, and I thought, yeah, would it be interesting to think that the combination of peace and joy could actually equal hope? How do we feel about that? Yeah, but you know, when we look at the dictionary to find out what the word hope means and you go, you break it down. Well, the Apostle Paul would say this. This is the kind of hope that I have discovered in Jesus, and this is the expression of it. This is how I feel. There's a peace and there's a joy that's about it. There's a strength and there's a faith that's about that, and it's an overflow within me. So here is the Apostle Paul, and he says, I pray. So he's praying, God, who is the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace. Now, who's up for that today? Okay, we're going to pray and we're just going to put that into prayer form. And I want you to engage with that. Okay, I don't want this just to be a lecture or a sermon. I want this to be a dialogue between you and God right now. Because if we're starting to preach messages of hope, it's going to be confronting some of the hopeless parts of your life. Okay, we've all got them. We've all got them, okay? So don't think that because I stand up here and I can declare hope that there's not a part of my life that I wished had been different or wished had changed or anything like that. So I want you to start thinking in prayer right now, what is it that I would like this hope to be filled with when joy and peace enter my soul? Is that okay? Can we pray that together? So just bow your heads, we're going to pray. Father, you are the source of hope, and I love that Paul had that encounter. I love that Paul prayed it, and I wonder how many people have prayed that kind of prayer for their churches, for their families, for themselves. If I think of 2,000 years and millions and billions of Christians that have read that and go, oh, I'd like a piece of that. So Father, this morning, as we think about the hopeless areas of our lives, Father, that your hope will invade those areas, will break down the walls of unbelief or doubt. And may hope invade. May we feel and encounter his joy, which is strength. May we feel and encounter his peace, which leads us to a place of contentment in him as we trust in him. So, Father, I pray that as we've looked into our own imaginations, our own being of the things, Father, that you are calling out of and away from hopelessness to hope, that today that your spirit will break into those areas of our lives. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. In Romans chapter 4, we have Abraham, and the Bible says in Romans chapter 4, verse 18, it says, even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping. How do we feel about that? When you have no reason to hope, think about that. Those areas in your life that you think are hopeless, where you have no reason to hope, Abraham makes a choice. When Abraham had every reason to doubt, and he had no reason to hope, yet he hoped. And if you think about your hopeless situation, if I can just put that in inverted commas right now, because I don't think it's hopeless, because there's always hope. In those situations they are presenting to you, you probably have every reason to doubt. It could be the past. It could be that something's never happened for you like this before, so you think it's never going to happen for you. It could be a past hurt or a past wound, a relationship that's gone south. It could be a myriad of things. You might have every reason to doubt and no reason to hope, but today you choose to hope. That is called faith. That is called faith. Abraham, and we know his story, we know why the Bible speaks of Abraham like this, because Abraham couldn't have kids. Now, you might look at Abraham's story and say, man, he's got no reason to be upset. The dude was rich. He had land, he had fields, he had cattle, he had sheep, he had servants, he had money, he had everything that he could possibly want. The only thing he didn't have was children. And Abraham is like, there is such a poverty on me right now. And everyone just goes, why in the poverty? Dude, you got everything. And but if you spoke with Abraham, he'd say, I have nothing. There's this one area of my life that's hopeless. And maybe he's blamed Sarah to say, well, you can't have kids. And maybe Sarah's blamed him to say, well, probably it's your problem. You can't have kids. Whatever the problem is, this marriage has not produced any children. And it's got to a place where Abraham had every reason to doubt. His wife is 90 by the time she has a baby. That's when you have every reason to doubt. Is that okay to say that? When he had every reason to doubt, God breaks into his world and says to him, you are going to be the father of nations. Now, how does Abraham greet that? He doesn't high-five God. He's like, well, how's that possible? How can that be? My wife is advanced in age, and I just don't think she's going to have. Anyway, God leads Abraham into an encounter. It's just him and Abraham. And if you read through Genesis, you'll see how God himself came and walked with Abraham, and that there was a big sacrifice of a bull, and God and Abraham kind of walked through the midst of it, and God's voice was clear to Abraham. And so there is God with Abraham, and he's speaking into him, and he's calling him to hope when he had no reason to hope. In Abraham, and you hear me say this a lot, his ability to hold on to God's voice was beyond his ability to doubt. We often have our voices of doubt and our voice of God, and often they're at war. And at church, it's easy to hear God's voice stronger than doubt. But when we go home and we have our ordinary week, our voices of doubt grow, and it's a war. But for Abraham, he found himself in a relationship with the Father in heaven where he valued his voice. Doesn't mean he didn't have doubts. And if you know Abraham's story, you know that he did. But what it means is he kept coming back to God. When Abraham had every reason to doubt and no reason to hope, still he hopes. And he goes back to Sarah and he says to Sarah, we're going to have a child. And again, what does Sarah do? How does she respond? She doesn't high-five Abraham. Didn't do that class in high school. But I'm pretty sure it doesn't work that way, Abraham. The Bible goes on to say, because Abraham chose to hope, God increased his faith. Who's up for that? Okay, can you see and can you hear I'm calling you into the hardest parts of your life? Because if you've been called to hope in where it's been hopeless, and if you can stand in that place, then God's looking at that and say, that's what faith looks like. That's where your testimony grows. That's where it's uncomfortable at times. But I'm telling you, here is the pattern where Abraham had every reason to doubt and no reason to hope. He chooses hope. God blesses him with faith. And the Bible then says God makes him righteous, or God makes him right, just like we spoke at this table. When hope and faith get together, a relationship with God is what overflows. Can you hear that? Much like with the sauce bottle, with satisfaction and joy, right? When this gets together with steak, things overflow. When hope and faith get together with God, a relationship starts overflowing. Isn't that good? That deserves an amen. Yeah, okay. Thank you, Claudia. That deserves an amen, because that's where we are. Okay, so here's Abraham. And he goes back to Sarah, says, we're going to have a child, and Sarah decides to criticize him. It's not going to happen. Are you thinking straight, Abraham. And she laughs. The Bible says she laughs. And God hears the mockery and the laughter and all that sort of stuff. And who wouldn't? Who wouldn't? The quickest way to disempower hope is to mock something, criticize something. The quickest way to disempower the hope that is within you is to say God can't do it. Is that a yes or a no? What do you think? The quickest way to disempower. So remember how the last few weeks we've been going through Nehemiah? Building the wall, they get halfway through and they're doing great. They're like 25 days are come and gone. It's halfway done. How good it is. But all of a sudden, the people of God who are doing the building work start complaining by saying, we don't have enough people. There's too much garbage. There's not enough resource. And all of the work stops because the complaint and the mockery has disempowered the hope. So what does Nehemiah do? He gets back up in the pulpit and he speaks out this great message of do not be afraid. Do not let fear change the destiny or the course of your life. And in that space of faith, in that space of hope becomes a place of faith. And before you know it, there's a relationship with God that has been reopened to the people. And 25 days later, this wall is finished and they are rejoicing on top of it. The quickest way to disempower is to mock something or criticize something. The quickest way to empower is to step in that place of hope and belief. Do you remember Jairus in the New Testament? We spoke briefly about him last week. Jairus comes to Jesus because hope has been empowered. Jesus says, yeah, I'm coming. Empowers Jairus again. That's good. The servant comes from the home and says to Jairus, your daughter's dead. Stop bothering the master. That disempowers the hope. Jairus turns to Jesus and Jesus says, let's just go have a look anyway because I think she's asleep. He's empowering the hope. They get to the house and the mourners, so they employ mourners to grieve when someone dies in the first century. And they're wailing. And they get there and Jesus says, move aside, girl's just sleeping. And there's Jairus and he's wanting to believe that. He's on board with that. And they all start laughing. They're mocking Jesus because they're going, she's not sleeping, brother. She's dead. Obviously not a doctor. Yeah, but I'm kind of the one who made the doctors, so just move aside. Just see what I can do, right? Isn't that cool? Isn't that just the coolest thing? When Jesus just goes, let's just see. It's the Son of God, but mockery doesn't disempower him. His relationship with the Father is set, right? And we can just go, well, that's Jesus, right? But what about Abraham? He's a legend, right? But he's still human, like Christ. And when Abraham had every reason to doubt and no reason to hope, he hoped. And it was accredited to him as faith. Then he got given a relationship with the Father in heaven. And that voice seemed to keep overwhelming the hopelessness. I love it. I often think of times in the Bible, like when the lepers came to Jesus. And everyone's running away. Like the hope has been disempowered. Like, I don't want to have a leper touch me because if a leper touched me, I'll get what they've got. And that's a hopeless sort of place to be. And Jesus goes, let's just see what I can do with that. And he steps into that place. And right there, as he reaches out to a leper, before he even touches him, hope is already being empowered. When everyone runs away from a leper, that disempowers the leper to believe that God can do anything. And so when you run away from people rather than help people, you are actually disempowering them. When you choose not to love them, you are disempowering them. But when you choose to love, there is something that occurs that just makes your world bigger. It makes your world bigger. Hope is empowered when Zacchaeus climbs a tree. He's heard about Jesus and he wants to know him. Hope is further empowered when Jesus stops at the bottom of that tree and says, Zacchaeus, tonight I'm having dinner with you. Hope is further empowered at that dinner table where Jesus reveals who he is and what he's on the planet to do. And that's what we assume to be the conversation there as Zacchaeus. Hope is empowered when Zacchaeus changes and transforms and walks out there and says, I'm going to give back everything I've stolen fourfold. Is that not being empowered? But you have people around Jesus and Zacchaeus saying, why are you eating with such scum? Hope is trying to be disempowered. You can see the battle. You can see the war. And there is Zacchaeus, and he can feel the feelings of the people that are around them. And none of them are good. Every one of them is hostile. But he's sensing something of what God is doing within him. And he's desiring to step out into a place of hope, which brings him to a place of faith, which brings him to a place of relationship. There is Zacchaeus, who has come to the source of hope, who is now completely filled with joy and peace because he trusts him. And the Bible says that I pray that God will overflow you with a confident hope. Now, who here would like to be overflowing with a confident hope? I would love to be. I would like to believe I am most times. I often ask people what they overflow with or what they leak. And I think it's a very good self-reflection to think is, what do people meet when they meet me? What do they sense first? Do they sense someone who's defensive? Do they sense someone who is critical? Do they sense someone who just doesn't want to befriend anybody? Do they sense someone who is weighed down with the weight of the world? Do they sense someone with the power and the presence of Christ? Like, who's up for that, right? That's everyone. Well, that's a pattern of choice. That's a pattern of walking into a place of hope. That's a pattern of being like Abraham. And when you have every reason to doubt and you have no reason to hope, you still choose to hope. To hope. There are people like that in this very room. The hope of Christ is in so many of you, and I look around, I know so many of your lives. And I know at times where the hopelessness has been, and the hopelessness may be still there, but you continue to step into places of hope. And I wonder whether this morning we could submit ourselves to the great prayer of the Apostle Paul. And if he was here, he wouldn't be saying the great Apostle Paul. He's just call me Paul. Just call me Paul. And he goes, could I pray for you? The Apostle Paul was criticized because he couldn't speak very well. But the way we remember him as a Christian church is that he is this great, bold speaker. Some dude fell asleep while he was preaching one day and died. That's not a good day in anyone's language, right? Particularly as a preacher. That's disempowering hope right there. He did bring him back to life, mind you, but that was a very empowering moment. But the Apostle Paul would just say, the Spirit of God is within me. And I'm wondering if I could pray for you. Now, the Christian response for that should be, step forward, because I want that prayer. This 21st century response is to sit back and say, well, if you feel okay doing that, just fine, just do it. And if anything changes, that's okay too. Now, the Christian response is to stand up and stand forward and say, in hope, I'm going to stand against where I have every reason to doubt, where I have no reason to hope. I am still going to hope. Who's up for that today? When joy and peace come together, hope overflows. That's Paul's words. That's his testimony. I found God, who is my source of hope. Now, there's hope. That's what God gives. Faith is the expression of it. Joy and peace is what he walks into. And he says, then when all that occurs, there is an overflow of hope that he's praying for a church. So Paul's just going, I'm just Paul. But this is an encounter, an experience that everyone should be able to walk through when there is no reason to hope. Isn't that interesting? It's easy to walk into a place of hope when there's every reason to hope. It's very difficult when there's no reason to hope. But therein lies the choice of faith. And this morning, as we finish, I want you guys to stand and step into this place of hope as I pray for you. Ready to pray together? I might just get Jake to come up and start playing, if that's all right, Jake. Just Jake. Thank you. I want you to stand up. Do you remember how at the start of the message I had you reflect on what is hopeless? And I know for many of us, I can include myself in that, I do not enjoy spending time where I'm hopeless. I would in fact say that I would like to do anything else other than spend time in that place. But what I have discovered is Jesus wants to show up in those places. I've discovered it doesn't always end the way that I want it to end, but I've discovered that He wants to overflow something into me if I'm willing to step out into those places of hope. You ready to pray? Father in heaven, the source of all hope, may you fill completely each person in this church with your peace and joy as they trust in you. May the confident hope that is in you then overflow through the power of the Holy Spirit. There's so many truths in that one little verse. The power of the Holy Spirit is here today, doing things already that you cannot imagine, but drawing us to a place of transformation. So in this place, in this past hour, you have been transforming. You have been changing. Some of the areas have been challenging. Some of them you just want to shut down. But today, the Father is calling you into hope. He's calling you to trust that He's got you. Even when you don't understand, even when you're just plain mad at Him, He is there. He's leading and He is guiding. He is loving you before you loved Him. He's already forgiven you before you even asked to be forgiven. He is making you family. He has made you family. And this morning, in this place, He desires to overflow within you the great things of the kingdom. And so, Father, we can joke about a bottle of sauce and the wonders that it brings. But this morning, I look around this church and I see lives of faith, lives of hope. There's joy in some of you guys. There's peace. There's wisdom. There's discernment. There's healing. There's words of prophecy. Could we just stop for a moment, Father, and allow us to reflect on what happens when we gather with our hearts open, with us stepping out into places of hope, when we start engaging with the overflow of the kingdom, when we are empowered with hope. So Father, this morning, empower your people with hope as we declare that Christ truly is enough, and that we have decided to follow you, to become like you. So may the God who is the source of all hope fill you completely today with His peace and with His joy because of your trust in Him. And may you overflow with the confident hope that comes to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So Father, we just, these are declarations, age-old declarations, but ones today that we make in the fresh faith and hope that is right here in this room. So again, Father, you are the source of hope. Fill us completely with this joy and peace because of our trust in you. Then overflow us, Father, with the confident hope that comes only through the power of the Holy Spirit. May this be our testimony. May this be our experience and our encounter as we grow to know you better. So, Father, now release us in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Come on downstairs and have a cup of coffee.